Hear, O Crest Hill, and be careful to obey, that it may go well with you, and that you may increase greatly. Last week we looked and listened to God and heard God speak from Deuteronomy chapter 6, the third verse. Last week we learned that listening to God and obeying God is both critical and essential if it is to go well with us, individually, in our homes, in our marriages, in our daily lives, on the job, in the schoolroom, wherever we find ourselves. But more than that, if it is to go well with us collectively, we, the body of Christ that He has planted on this corner of His kingdom and given the name Crest Hill, if it is to go well with us, and if we are to increase greatly. Last week we learned that it is critical and essential for us to both listen and obey God if we are to increase greatly numerically and relationally. Today we are going to examine three more ways God wants to grow us. Listening to God and obeying God is both critical and essential. Also, if we are to, watch this now, increase financially. Jesus talked about money. 1/6 of the Gospels, that's Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, 1/6 of those and 1/3 of the parables of Jesus address the subject of money and the management of it. Jesus dealt with money matters because money matters. I find it fascinating that there are many who walk this earth, there are many who populate this planet, but even more so, there are many that are seated in houses of worship, just like you are today, that either don't know or don't believe or don't want to believe that Jesus says anything about money. It is God's will, as revealed in God's Word, for us to increase financially. Thank you, Ray. Hello? Are you there? I see you, but I hear nothing. It is God's will for us to increase financially. Oh, you're happy being where you are? You're satisfied with your meager mediocrity? Who am I talking to? It is God's will, revealed in God's Word, for us to increase financially. Now the question comes, why? Is it so that we can live and lead selfish lives as the practitioners of prosperity theology? It is so that we can have sanctuaries that look like museums, housing spiritual activities more akin to mausoleums? Is it so that I, your senior pastor, can live in a $1 billion home, travel in a $1 billion jet, and earn a $1 billion annual salary? No. Did you all see the ride I came up in this morning? No. Here's why it is God's will for you individually and for us collectively called Crest Hill to increase financially. It is so that we can become conduits of God's currency. It is so that we can be conduits of God's currency, and so that we can respond to the opportunities that God gives us to reach people for Christ, disciple people for Christ, and send people out to share the life-changing message of Christ. That is why God wants us to increase financially. It is so the next time one of you comes to me and says, Pastor, I've been doing what you've been telling me to do. I've been praying, and I've been fasting, and I've been journaling, and I've been going before God, and He's laid this new ministry on my heart. I won't have to look at you and say, God bless you. I wish we could do that, but we just don't have the money. Church, God has given us all the money that we need to carry out His will here at Crest Hill. I've been praying, and I've been fasting, and I've been in God's Word, and God told me we've got all the money we need to do what we need to do. And He revealed to me where to find it. Want to know where? It's in our pockets. And the only way for it to make its way out of your bank account, your Michael Kors, Louis Vuitton, Coach purses. Y'all didn't know I knew that, did you? The only way that will happen is if we listen carefully and radically obey God, living lives of holistic biblical stewardship. Let me break that down for you. That means that God owns everything and He wants you and me to take care of it. Tithing and giving to the glory of God. Hear, O Crest Hill, let us listen and obey so that we will increase financially in a great way. Let us also listen to God and obey Him radically so that we will increase ministerially. Yes, this means added staff, but more so it means your ministry. It means increased ministry. It means every one of us knows our Lord. It means every one of us knows our spiritual gifts. Every one of us has been developing them and actively putting them into practice, advancing and building up Christ's kingdom every single day of our lives. Lloyd Corey, in his book, quote unquote, writes, "The ministry of the church is a ministry of people. When a church lives, it lives because the people within that church are vital and active. When a church dies, it withers and dies, not because the brick and the mortar and the carpet and the pews get old and begin to crack and rip and crumble. The church withers and dies because the people who are the church wither and die." I think a vivid illustration of this comes from the story of a young pastor in the state of Oklahoma who went to a little, though long-standing, church. He came into the church starry-eyed, hopes aglow of reviving this stagnant, dying congregation. And everything that he did and tried failed until one day he decided to do one more thing. And so what he did is that he called the local newspaper. If you've lived in a small town, you know what I'm talking about. He called the local newspaper and he asked them to publish a news story saying that this coming Sunday, that in the final service of the church, they were going to have a funeral for the church. And so the ad went in the paper, and come Sunday, there were people that got there 20 minutes early to get a good seat. People that had not been there in decades. This little church that would have a high attendance of maybe 12 on Easter Sunday was now bulging at the seams, and the windows were open, and people were on their tiptoes trying to look in and see this unusual funeral service. And what was interesting was, as the pulpit was, as in many traditional country churches, up on the platform and then right in front of it where the communion table would be located, there was a casket. And the casket was covered in flowers. And at the conclusion of the pastor's eulogy, he invited the entire community to come, as was the practice in that community and as in many small towns and communities, to form a line and file and make their way past the casket to pay their final respects to the dead church. And so he came down from the pulpit and he pushed the flowers and the casket was smothered in flowers, and he lifted the lid. And slowly but surely, every one of them began to file past and gaze in. Rise up and walk away rather sheepishly. And one by one, they filed past the casket. And what he had placed inside the casket was this, a mirror. So that when they looked in, they could see the church that had died. I don't know about you, but I thank God that's not my church. I thank God that's not our church. I thank God that we are vibrant. I thank God that we are active. I thank God that God is. Did you know that there are individuals from other churches that come to us trying to find out who we are and how we do what we do? I have people come to me all the time and say, I've heard about your church. What kind of a church is it? And I'm like, I don't have a freaking idea. But I know God is moving and active and alive. I thank God when somebody asks me, hey, how are things going at your church? I can look at them and say, as my grandfather taught me, I'm busier than a one-armed paper hanger. Here at Crest Hill, we go from one great event to the next. We go from one awesome experience to the next. We go from one fantastic opportunity to the next. But I came today to tell you that we have just scratched the surface. God wants to take us higher and farther and greater than we've ever gone before. I came today to tell you that I have prayed. I came today to tell you that I have journaled. I came today to tell you that I have fasted. And if you will, I have been to the mountaintop. And I've looked over and I've seen the promised land. And paying homage to Dr. King, applying his words to our opportunity, it is ours if we will listen and if we will obey. And when we do that, we will get to the promised land. Ministries touching millions, a worldwide training center preparing ministers for ministry, television, radio, and internet outreach, ministries to our inner cities, empowering the impoverished, providing jobs and housing and training and education through economic empowerment, transforming what are often dungeons of doom into havens of hope. Satellite churches of Crest Hill planted not just throughout our region, but hear me now, but across our nation. Special needs churches planted not just across our nation, but across our world. And God wants to do this. And God will do this if we will but listen attentively and obey him radically. Listening to God and obeying God is both critical and essential if we're going to increase greatly in our ministry. And the final point I want to share with you today, you're saying it's 11:22, what's he doing? I'm leaving plenty of time to open this altar. The final point I want to share with you today is this: listening to God and obeying God is critical and essential if we are to greatly increase, hear me now please, spiritually. Leadership Magazine, known for its choice cartoons about church, made me smile several years ago with this one. There is a grim-faced preacher who pauses during the middle of his sermon when one of the ushers runs in and hands him a note. And he reads the note that said, and I quote, "We interrupt this sermon to inform you that the fourth grade boys are now in complete control of their Sunday school class. P.S. They are holding Miss Mosby hostage." Sadly, this is the most exciting thing that could happen in a lot of worship services. in most American churches. John Broadus, who was a great Baptist leader of another generation in the mid-1800s, said that in worship, those of us that lead worship, the greatest sin that we can commit is to make worship boring. Would it surprise you if I were to tell you that yawn fests are nothing new in churches? Richard K. Wallerub, in the January 17, 1979 issue of Christianity Today, put together the following fictional dialogue between Jesus and his disciples, giving it, how shall I say, a bit of a modern twist. Pete, this meeting has been called at the request of Matt, John, Tom, and little Jim. Bart, would you please open in prayer? Bart, Almighty God, we ask your blessings on all we do and say earnestly, praying that you will see our side as your side. Amen. Pete, Jesus, we've been following you around for some time now, and we're getting concerned about the attendance figures. Tom, how many were on the hill yesterday? 37. Pete, it's getting to be ridiculous. You're going to have to pep things up, Jesus. We expect things to happen, John. I'd like to suggest that you pull off more miracles. That walking on the water bit was the most exciting thing I've ever seen. But only a few of us saw it. If 1,000 or so had a chance to witness it, we would have more than we could handle on the hill. Little Jim, I agree. The healing of miracles are terrific, but only a limited number really get to see what has happened. Let's have more water to wine, more fish and chips. You know, you can't go wrong when you feed a crowd. Still more storms, give more signs, give the people what they need. Pete, right. And another thing, publicity is essential. And you tell half the people you cure to be quiet. Let the word get around. Matt, I'm for miracles, but I want to hear a few more stories I can understand. This, those who have ears to hear, let them hear business, just clouds the issue. You have to make it clear, or most of us aren't going to be able to take anything home. Big Jim, I'd like to offer an order of service. Jesus, consider this. First a story, then a big miracle, followed by an offering. Then maybe saying or something, you know, followed by a small miracle to bring them back next time. Oh, yes, and pray if you'd like. Tom, we have to do something, little Jim, that's for sure. Attendance has been awful. Oh, and at the end, Judas chimes in. Judas, I'd like to say if we're going to continue to meet in this upper room, we ought to do something about this carpet. All of that changed at the cross. All of that changed at the empty tomb. All of that changed on the day of Pentecost when the Holy Spirit came to reside within the heart of every genuine believer then and since. All of that changed. And with the exception of Judas, every one of the apostles was radically, radically sold out for Christ. And hear me, please. God used this ragtag, motley crew, bunch of misfits, and change the world. I'm looking out at a gathering this morning of some of the brightest and the best in our region. And if God could do that with them, can you imagine what he could do with us? If God could change the world with them, imagine what God wants to do with us today. Not to make it upside down, but right side up. Imagine what God could do. More love, more power, more of you in my life, and I will worship you with all of my heart, and I will worship you with all of my mind, and I will worship you with all of my strength, for you are my Lord. That Crest Hill must be our song. That Crest Hill must be our prayer. That Crest Hill must be our desire for God to give us more and more and more spiritual power in our lives. Anybody want more? Does anybody want more? It is God's will to give you more. It is God's will to give you more. It is God's will to give us more. He longs to do that. He yearns to do that. He wants to give us more and more and more so that we can be more and more and more and do more and more and more to the glory of God. Is anybody with me? Hear, O Crest Hill, and be careful to obey, that it may go well with you, and that you may increase greatly. Hey, Crest Hill, are you listening?